Dear students, let us discuss about formulation of tablets, unit 2 from Industrial Pharmacy 1. The contents of this presentation are for education purpose only and not for any commercial interest. The intention of the presentation is to explain formulation of tablets and various granulation methods. Learning outcome. After this session, student will be able to know steps involved in formulation of tablets, to analyze the advantages of granulation or why there is need of granulation, to choose suitable granulation method, to choose suitable granulating liquid, and also able to explain granulation mechanism. The first step in the tablet formulation is particle size reduction and sizing. Second step is blending, then granulation, then drying and compaction. So tablets are compressed into the desired weight, shape and size, either by direct compression or by compression of granules. The first step, that is particle size reduction and sizing. This is an important step in the process of tablet manufacturing. Sizing or size reduction is achieved either by milling, crushing, grinding or pulverization. In manufacturing of compressed tablets, the mixing and or blending of several solid pharmaceutical ingredients is easier and more uniform if the ingredients are about same size. Here, active pharmaceutical ingredient and other essential tablet excipients are mixed and blended. So, for uniform mixing and blending or blending, there is need the particles or the particles, that is excipient particle size as well as active pharmaceutical ingredient size, particle size should be same and uniform. This provides a greater uniformity of dose. A fine particle size is essential in the case of lubricant mixing with granules for its proper function. The lubricant also should have with fine particle size for proper mixing with granules. Advantages of size reduction are increased surface area means increased dissolution rate. And increased surface area is achieved by decreasing the particle size, and as the dissolution rate is high, hence the absorption and obviously the bioavailability is also high, because bioavailability is rate and extent of absorption. Improved tablet to tablet content uniformity due to larger number of particles per unit weight. So as the particle size is reduced, number of particles per unit weight also increase, and this helps to improve the content uniformity of the tablet dosage form. Control particle size distribution of dry granulation or mix to promote better flow of mixture in tablet machine. Control particle size distribution also helps to achieve the improved flow properties and improved color or active ingredient dispersion in tablet excipients. Uniformly sized wet granulation to promote uniform drying. So uniform drying also can be achieved if during wet granulation, uniform size granules are prepared. Though different or several advantages are there of particle size reduction, some of the disadvantages are during particle size reduction, an active pharmaceutical ingredient may converted into the different polymorphic form, which may be the less inactive or maybe unstable or less stable. A decrease in bulk and density of active compound and or excipients, which may cause flow problem and segregation in the mix. As the particle size is reduced, there is a decrease in the bulk density of the particles, either active ingredient or excipients, and this may result into the segregation, that is demixing of the tablet particles, formulation ingredient particles. An increase in surface area from size reduction may promote the adsorption of air, which may inhibit wettability of the drug to the extent that it becomes the limiting factor in the dissolution rate. So air entrapment possibility may be there due to size reduction, and this may also results into the defective tablet, or it limits the dissolution rate. These are the various equipment which are used to achieve the size reduction: multi-mill, hammer mill, ball mill, colloidal mill, conical mill, roller mill, cutting mill, and fluid energy mill. Powder blending. Powder mixing and blending is more challenging than mixing the liquid. Means mixing of solid formulation ingredients is more challenging than the mixing of liquid ingredients. This may challenging to attain perfect uniformity due to inherent cohesiveness and resistance to movement which exist between the individual powder particles. Difference in size, shape, and density of the powder particle may result into substantial segregation, that is, demixing may take place. The powder or granules may be blended at the pre-granulation and or post-granulation stage of tablet manufacturing. So powder mixtures or different formulation ingredients are blended before granulation as well as after granulation. Granulation is the process in which primary powder particles are made to adhere to form larger multi-particle entities called granules. Pharmaceutical granules typically have a size range between 0.2 to 4 millimeter depending on their subsequent use. What is the difference between the agglomerate and granule? Agglomerate is the buildup of small particles into larger aggregates without any addition of binding agent or use of mechanical force, whereas granulation is the buildup of small particles into larger aggregates but with the aid of binding agent or mechanical force, or using the vehicle or solvent like water, starch paste, and also achieve with the specialized equipment like roller compaction if it is dry granulation. Agglomeration often occurs without intention during manufacturing operations such as dense powder conveying or sieving, sifting, mixing, and grinding. So during these processes, the agglomeration of the small powder particles takes place without any intention, and it takes place spontaneously, whereas granulation is a planned operation. Special procedure is carried out to convert the small particles into larger aggregates with the help of binding agent as well as water or starch paste, or with the use of mechanical force such as roller compaction technique. Why granulation? So during tablet manufacturing, first the active pharmaceutical ingredient, that is drug, as well as different tablet excipients are reduced to the uniform size, and then they are mixed. And after mixing, if these excipients as well as the active ingredient do not have ideal compaction characteristics, then there is need to convert them into the granular form so that the tablet can be compressed successfully. So why granulation? To prevent the segregation of the constituents of the powder mix and to control particle size distribution. So particle size distribution should be proper, and also to avoid the demixing of the constituents, to improve the compaction characteristics of the mix, to improve powder flow, to increase the bulk density, to achieve more uniform particle size, to reduce punch face adherence, that is sticking, which is one of the tablet manufacturing defect. Another tablet manufacturing defect is capping. And it can be avoided by granulation, and to ensure operator safety. So let us see one by one how these are helpful or how these can be achieved by granulation. Here, different powder particles are there, which are utilized to form the tablet. So here active ingredient is there as well as different pharmaceutical excipients are there which are essential for the tablet compression. So if you observe, solid circles are there, hollow circles are there, and dashed line circles are there. These represent that they have different densities. So the powder particles which are more dense, they settle down at the bottom. Less dense than that will be at the middle layer, and the powder particles which are having low density than these two of particles, they will settle at the or remain at the top of the powder. So in this way, demixing of the powder takes place. But if this powder is converted into the granulation by proper granulation, using proper granulation method, then after sieving, we will achieve the monosize granules, and this will help to prevent the demixing. So segregation means demixing, and it is due to different size or density of the components of the powder mixture. So smaller and denser particles concentrate at the base of the container at the bottom layer, and with the larger and or less dense ones above them. And ideal granulation will result in correct proportion of all these constituents of the mix in each granule, and segregation of the ingredients will not occur. So this is the first advantage of granule. To improve the flow properties of the mix, so many powders, because of their small size, irregular shape, and irregular surface characteristics, are cohesive and do not flow well. So if the powder flow is poor from the hopper, there are chances of weight variation within the final product owing to variable fill of tablet dies. So once the powder flows from the hopper, it will fill the die cavity, and then the tablet will be compressed. So granulation of this cohesive powder, if the powder is possessing poor flow properties due to the different size or small size or irregular shape and surface characteristics, then granulations of this powder will help to produce larger and more isodiametric granules, and thus improve the flow properties of the powder. To improve the compaction characteristics of the mix, so some powders are difficult to compact even on addition of binder or compactable adhesive. So granulation of such powders often produce formulation which is more easily compacted and produce stronger tablets. So some of the powders, they do not have ideal compaction characteristics. They can't be directly compressed. Though we add the directly compressible vehicles into that, or sometimes binder or adhesive, compactable adhesive, still there are problem in the compaction of this tablet. So at that time, these tablets are converted into the desired granular form to produce the stronger tablets. This is due to the distribution of the adhesive within the granule. Adhesive addition helps to impart the adhesive forces into the powder particles, and this will result into the large multi-particulate granule. Often, solute migration occurring during the post-granulation drying stage results in binder-rich outer layer to the granules. In the next slides, we are going to discuss about the granulation stages. And in granulation stages, once the adhesive or binder is mixed with the powder mixture, then it is blended. Adhesive is mixed either in the solution form or in the dry form, and then these are passed through the sieve, and we get the desired granules. And then these granules are dried at room temperature for particular time, specified period of time. And during drying, what happens? Evaporation of the solvent takes place, which is added before or during granulation stage. And the binder is solubilized in the solvent. And once the granules are dried, this solvent, it migrates or evaporates. And during its migration from the central core of the granules to the surface, it also migrates binder towards the surface of the granule, and this will help to produce the strong granules with good friability. This in turn leads to direct binder-binder bonding, which assists the consolidation of weakly bonding materials. Other approaches behind granulation are, so some of the powder materials, they are toxic, and granulation will reduce the hazard associated with the generation of toxic dust that may arise when powders are handled by the operator. So by granulation, operator safety can be achieved. Granules should be non-friable and have a suitable mechanical strength to avoid hazard due to dust. Granulation of slightly hygroscopic powder may prevent adherence and cake formation upon storage, as the granules absorb some moisture and retain their flowability. So if the slightly hygroscopic powder, it is packed as it is, then there are chances that this powder may absorb the moisture from the atmosphere and may form a compact cake or cohesive mass, sticky mass. But if this powder is converted into the granular form, then though the granules absorb moisture, but they retain their flowability. Granules are more denser than the parent powder mix, hence low bulkiness. Bulkiness means the volume occupied by the granule, bulk volume. So low bulkiness and occupy less volume per unit weight, therefore more convenient for storage or shipment. Methods of granulation. There are two types of methods for granulation: primary or basic methods of granulation, dry granulation and wet granulation. Used for drugs that do not compress well after wet granulation and drugs which are sensitive to moisture, for these things dry granulation is followed. Wet granulation involves the massing of a mix dry primary powder particles using a granulating fluid, mainly the volatile solvent, which can be removed by drying and non-toxic is used. So typical liquids which are used as a granulating liquid are water, ethanol, isopropanol, either alone or in combination, and may contain a dissolved adhesive or binder or binding agent used to ensure particle adhesion once the granule is dry. For water sensitive drugs, organic solvents are used as granulating liquid as an alternative to dry granulation or for rapid drying of granules. Let us discuss the dry granulation. In the dry methods of granulation, the primary powder particles are aggregated under high pressure. So in dry granulation, granulating liquid along with binder is not added, but here binder is added in the dry form, and then high pressure is applied. Application of the high pressure helps to form the adhesive, increase the adhesion between the powder particles and helps to form the granule. So two main processes are there in dry granulation. The first is slugging, that is large tablet formation, which is also called as a slug and is produced in a heavy duty tableting press. So similar way the tablet is compressed, this powder is compressed into the slug or large tablet. Then roller compaction is the another process or method for dry granulation, in which the powder is squeezed between two rollers to produce a sheet of material. In both cases, these intermediate products are broken using a suitable milling technique to produce granular material, which is usually sieved to separate the desired size fraction. So in both methods, here the slug is formed and here the sheet is formed. So this slug or sheet is broken into the desired size granular material. The unused fine material may be reworked to avoid waste. So during conversion of this slug or sheet into the small granules, there may be the chances of fine material is produced, and this fine material is reused in the granulation process again to avoid the waste. Dry granulation may be used for drugs that do not compress well after wet granulation or those which are sensitive to moisture. This is the flow diagram which explains the dry granulation. So drug is grinded, means size reduction of the drug is carried out. Then adjuvants are added, means different tablet formulation ingredients like binder or adhesive or bulking agent, disintegrating agent, glidant. So these are added and they are blended. So blending means mixing of these all ingredients is done, and this powder material is then, or powder mixture is then passed through the roller, and this roller converts this powder mixture into the form of pellet. Then these pellets are crushed and then screened through a suitable mesh size. And then after the desired size granules are produced, these are blended with the lubricant before tablet compression and then compress into the desired size tablet. So blending is done in the pre-granulation as well as at post-granulation stage. So in dry granulation, two methods are there, roller compaction and slugging. So in slugging, tablet compression machine is used. The powder mixture, which is blended properly for uniform mixing of the all ingredients throughout the powder mixture, then it is compressed and the slugs or larger tablets are produced and these are milled and sized to get the desired size granules. In another method, that is in the roller compaction, the powder mixture, blended powder mixture for which the tablet is to be prepared or the granules are to be formulated. So they are passed, this powder mixture is passed through the rollers and these rollers apply high pressure to form the compacts or flakes and then these are milled and sized to get the desired granules. So this is the schematic diagram which is explaining the two types of dry granulation processes, that is slugging and roller compaction. Slugging, this process involves compression of primary powder particles into large flat tablets or pellets using a tablet press or more usually a large heavy duty rotary press. The resultant compact is then milled using a hammer mill or other conventional milling equipment. The milled slugs are passed through a screen of desired mesh for sizing. Lubricant is added in the usual manner and the granules compressed into tablets. Slugging results in a considerable dust production which poses a problem for good containment and reduction of cross-contamination. There are chances of cross-contamination due to the dusting of the material. Other disadvantage of slugging is that batch processing, low output and poor process control, frequent maintenance of changeovers is required and poor economy of scale. So the method is being replaced by more modern and better roller compaction process. So it was used traditionally and now roller compaction is most widely used dry granulation method. So in the roller compaction, dry roller compaction is the process of using mechanical pressure to compress fine powders into denser sheets. The basic concept of compaction is to force fine powders between two counter rotating rolls. So here fine powder is rotated with the screw graved system and then it rotates between the two counter rotating rolls. As the volume decreases through the region of maximum pressure, the material is compressed into dense sticks or corrugated sheets and then it is crushed through this milling system and series of screens are there here and then this is the series of screen where then it is screened to get the uniform size granules. So this is the process of dry granulation by roller compaction. So the powder material is flowing and it is when it passed through the two rotating rollers. So due to application of the high pressure, these are converted into the sheets or pellets. Then they are crushed and then it is shifted through the vibrosifter like equipment to get the desired size granules. The fine material, it is again recirculated for dry granulation. So no waste of material. Wet granulation. Wet granulation method of tablet production involves the following processing steps. Step one is weighing and mixing of formulation ingredients, that is excluding the lubricant. Other formulation ingredients are mixed. Then preparing the damp mass, wet screening or screening the dampened powder into pellets or granules, then drying of moist granules, sizing the granulation by dry screening and lubrication of granules. So these are the different steps involved in the wet granulation method. This is the flow chart which describes wet granulation. So drug is converted into the desired size, particle size. Then different formulation ingredients except lubricant is added with the drug and then blended properly for proper mixing. Then this powder mixture into which the granulating liquid along with binder is added, and here damp mass is formed. Then this damp mass is passed through the sieve to form the pellets, and these pellets are then dried, and after drying these are screened through the desired mesh size, and then these granules are blended with lubricant and finally compressed into the desired shape and size tablet. So drying is done where the granulating liquid migrates towards the surface, and along with its migration it also carries binder to the surface of the granule during this drying process, and this results into the binder-binder adhesion or bonding, and it makes the preparation of or helps to prepare the strong granules. So this is the wet granulation process. So when the binder is added along with the granulating liquid, so these are the binder droplets in granulating liquid, and these are the powder mixture. So when it is added, so it forms a liquid bridge, that is a moistening of the dry powder. Then solid bridge formation takes place due to drying, and this is the finished agglomerate, that is granule. Different granulators are used. A high shear granulator consists of cylindrical or conical mixing bowl. So this is the bowl. Three blended impeller is there. So this is the impeller with three blade. Then chopper is there, which cuts the material. Auxiliary chopper is there, and the motor to drive the blades, and then discharge pot is also provided to collect the granule material. The high shear wet granulation process include five stages. So this represents the high shear granulator. Powder mixing is done, binder addition is done, or addition of granulating liquid, then wetting of powder and nucleation, then growth of granules and densification of the powder, granule attrition and breakage to achieve the desired size granules. Then this is the fluidized bed granulator. So this consists of gas plenum, that is gas inlet chamber. This is the chamber. Gas distribution, product container, then an expanded chamber containing a set of filter bag, binders, spray system, which is usually characterized by one of the four nozzle design. So here spray nozzle product container is here. Here it is the air inlet and air filter. Granulating liquid is added, and here is the exhaust filters are there, and here is the air outlet. So the product container means here powder mixture is put, and the spray nozzle, it sprays the granulating liquid, and the hot air is also supplied, which makes the carries the drying of the granules. So fluidized bed granulator is one of the commonly used processing equipment in the pharmaceutical industry. It is a multi-purpose equipment in that mixing, granulation and drying are all carried out in the same equipment. So this represents the FBD, that is fluidized bed dryer, for the preparation of granules. Then next is the spray dryer. Takes a liquid stream and separates the solute or suspension as a solid and the solvent into vapor. The solid is usually collected in a drum or cyclone. So here it is cyclone. this is the drying chamber. Drying gas is provided. Atomizer is there. And dry particles collector is there. Here is the exhaust gas. Liquid is fed through this atomizer into the drying chamber. The liquid input stream is sprayed through a nozzle into a hot vapor stream and vaporized. Solids form as moisture quickly leaves the droplets. A nozzle is usually used to make the droplets from 20 to 180 micrometer, maximizing heat transfer and the rate of water vaporization. So, two types of nozzles are there with the spray dryer. High pressure single fluid nozzle with 50 to 300 bars and two fluid nozzles. One fluid is the liquid to dry and the second is compressed gas, and generally at the air that is 1 to 7 bars. So preferred method of drying of many thermally sensitive materials such as foods and pharmaceuticals. So advantage of the spray dryer is that the material which are thermally sensitive can be converted into the granule by this spray drying technique. So this is the laboratory scale model of the spray dryer, and this is the industrial large scale model of the spray dryer. Extrusion spiritization technique is the most popular method of producing pellets. Involves four steps: the preparation of the wet mass, that is granulation, shaping the wet mass into cylinders, that is extrusion, breaking up the extrudate and rounding of the particles into spheres, that is spiritization, and drying of the pellets. So here the mass, it is passed, that is the extruded strands, these are passed, then these are converted into the cylindrical plates. So extruder is there, melt die plate is there, pelletizer, then rotating knives are there, and this convert the spherical pellets into the spherical form. And here is the exhaust to vacuum conveyor. So these are the different steps of extrusion and spiritization. First the damp mass is formed, weight mass, then it is converted into the extrudates, then breaking of the extrudates, and these broken extrudates are then converted into the spherical shape. So this is the extrudate which is used on the industrial scale. Advantages of extrusion spiritization are ability to incorporate higher levels of active components without producing excessively larger particles, which are larger particles which are produced in the dry granulation. Two or more active agents can be easily combined in any ratio in the same unit. Physical characteristics of the active ingredients and excipients can be modified. Particles having high bulk density can be formulated into the granules using extrusion spiritization. Low hygroscopicity, high sphericity is achieved. Dust-free particles, granules are prepared. Narrow particle size distribution and smoother surface can be produced. Granulating liquids which are used are organic solvents or water or some of the aqueous solvents. Organic solvents, the advantage is that drying time is rapid. Rapid drying is achieved, and as these are very volatile. But the disadvantage is that these are more expensive. And there is also, when these are disposed to the environment during drying, that is solvent evaporation takes place, and this is not environmentally safe. Water, it is affordable economically, non-flammable, environment friendly, but the advantage is that it may adversely affect the stability of the products. And longer drying times are required compared with the organic solvents, and therefore the material will be exposed for longer to abrasion and heat during drying of the granules. Effect of granulation method on granular structure. When we use the different granulation method, just what we discuss. So wet massing, if it is used, that is wet granulation method, if used to produce the granules, then the intact drug particles held together in a sponge-like matrix of binder. So this is the granule which are prepared through wet granulation. Then granules which are prepared using the FBD, so these are having greater porosity and the granule surface is covered by film of binding agent, whereas in wet granulation the drug particles are dispersed between the sponge like matrix of binder. Spray dryer when utilized to prepare the granules, so spherical particles composed of an outer shell and inner core of the particles are produced. So the type and capacity of granulating mixer significantly influence the work input and time necessary to produce a cohesive mass, adequate liquid distribution and intragranular porosity of the granular mass. The method and conditions of granulation affect intergranular and intragranular pore structure by changing the degree of packing within the granules. Granulation mechanism. Now this is the most important part of the granulation process or the tablet formulation. So what are the different mechanisms involved in the granulation process? So to form granules, bonds must be formed between the powder particles so that they adhere, and these bonds must be sufficiently strong to prevent breakdown of the granule to powder in subsequent handling operations. So they may be strong enough so that they should not be converted into the powder or dust. So five primary bonding mechanisms are there between particles. So the first is adhesion and cohesion forces in the immobile liquid films between individual primary powder particles. Second is interfacial forces in mobile liquid films within the granules. Third is formation of solid bridges after solvent evaporation during drying of granulation. Next is attractive forces between solid particles. And the last one is mechanical interlocking. So the first, adhesion and cohesion forces in the immobile liquid films. So the granulating liquid which is added along with binder, it may form the mobile liquid film or immobile liquid film. So when it forms the immobile liquid film, so presence of sufficient liquid forms a very thin immobile layer and hence decreases interparticulate distance, whereas increases the contact area between the particles. So powder particles are there, powder mixture is there, where the active ingredient plus different formulation ingredients are mixed. And here when the granulating liquid is added along with binder, so it forms a thin immobile layer between the particles and it decreases the interparticulate distance and increases the contact area between the particles. As van der Waals forces of attraction are proportional to the particle diameter and inversely proportional to the square of the distance of separation, bond strength between the particles will be increased. So as the interparticulate distance decreases, van der Waals force of attraction increases. Adsorbed moisture causes the cohesion of slightly damp powder. Such moisture films may be present as a residual liquid after granules prepared by wet granulation have been dried and may contribute significantly to the final granule strength. So during drying, the solvent evaporates, and one of the mechanisms is that this solvent, when it evaporates, it migrates towards the surface of the granule, and when it migrates, it also carries the binder, and this binder again form the binder-binder bonding at the surface of the granule. So these provide the strength, but sometimes the granulated liquid may remain as a residual film in the granule itself, and it also imparts the strength to the granule. Thin immobile layers may also be formed by highly viscous solutions of adhesives, and so the bond strength will be greater. So starch mucilage, which is highly viscous granulating liquid or fluid, it produces the granules with in dry granulation. However, the pressures used will increase the contact area between the adsorption layers and decrease the interparticulate distance, and this will contribute to the final granule strength. So in wet granulation, the immobile layers formed by the granulating liquid will provide the strength, and this may remain in the residual film form when the drying takes place. Whereas in dry granulation, the pressure which is applied either during slugging or roller compaction, it increases the contact area between the adsorption layers and decreases the interparticulate distance. Interfacial forces in mobile liquid films. So liquid added during wet granulation may distributed as films around the around and between particles. So sufficient liquid is usually added to produce a mobile film. So there are three states of water distribution between particles as shown in figure, that is the pendular state, funicular state and capillary state. So in pendular state, less than 20% of the granulating liquid is distributed as film, and at low moisture levels, that is pendular state, the particles are held together by lens shaped rings of liquid, and this causes adhesion because of the surface tension forces of the liquid air interface. So liquid may present in this space, and the surface tension forces at the liquid and air interface and the hydrostatic suction pressure in the liquid bridge. So when all the air has been displaced, so the granulation is done along with kneading mixing. So this kneading and mixing may displace the air which is present between the particles, and more amount of the granule liquid addition also achieves this state, and whatever the air is there, it is replaced with the solvent or granulating liquid. So, and the particles are held by capillary suction at the liquid air interface, which is now only at the granule surface. The funicular state represents an intermediate stage between the pendular and capillary stage. So this is the diagram which is explaining all the three stages, that is pendular, funicular and capillary. So funicular stage is the intermediate stage between the pendular and capillary stage. So in pendular stage, a small amount of granulating liquid is added. As granulating liquid is added continuously in a small amount along with kneading and mixing. So this helps to form the liquid bridges, but the air is present. And then when the air is displaced, then it is converted into the capillary stage. So dry state prior to granulation, then this is the pendular stage, and then this is the funicular state, this is the capillary state, and if the more amount of the liquid is added, then it may convert it into the suspension form. But suspension if dried, then it is converted into capillary stage. So G is the adding granulating fluid, and D is the drying. So state of the powder bed, most moist granules tensile strength increases about 3 times between the pendular and the capillary state. State of the powder bed is dependent upon the total moisture content of the weighted powders. Then capillary state may also reach by decreasing the separation of the particles. During wet granulation, continued kneading mixing of the material originally in the pendular state will densify the wet mass, decreasing the pore volume occupied by air and eventually producing the funicular or capillary state without further liquid addition. So kneading or mixing also helps to reach the capillary, funicular and capillary state, which helps to replace the air. But sometimes addition of more amount of granulating liquid also helps to achieve the funicular and capillary state. So liquid bridges are there which may convert into the solid bridges after drying of the granules, and it imparts the strength to the granule. In addition to these three states, a further state, that is the droplet state, is important in the process of granulation by spray drying of suspension. So in this state, the strength of the droplet is dependent upon the surface tension of the liquid used. So as the moist granules will be dried, liquid bridges are only temporary structures in wet granulation. Liquid bridges are prerequisite for the formation of solid bridges formed by adhesive present in the liquid or by materials that dissolve in the granulating liquid. The formation of solid bridges after solvent evaporation. So solid bridges are formed either by partial melting or by hardening of binders, or by crystallization of the dissolved substances. Partial melting. So in dry granulation, melting of low melting point materials occurs due to high pressure which is applied during slugging and direct roller compaction. So as particles touch each other, when the pressure is reduced, crystallization takes place, and this will help to bind the particles together. Another method of solid bridge formation is there, or mechanisms, hardening binders. So common mechanism in pharmaceutical wet granulations, when an adhesive is included in the granulating solvent. So the liquid will form liquid bridges and the adhesive will harden or crystallize on drying to form solid bridges to bind the particles. So adhesives such as polyvinyl pyrrolidone, the cellulose derivatives such as carboxymethyl cellulose and pre-gelatinized starch function in this way. Crystallization of dissolved substances. So the solvent used to mask the powder during wet granulation may partially dissolve one of the powder ingredients. When the granules are dried, crystallization of this material will take place and the dissolved substance then acts as a hardening binder. So any material soluble in the granulating liquid will function in this manner, that is lactose incorporated into dry powders granulated with water. So the size of the crystals produced in the bridge will be influenced by the rate of drying of the granules. The slower the drying time, the larger the particle size. It is therefore important that the drug does not dissolve in the granulating liquid and recrystallize, because it may adversely affect the dissolution rate of the drug if crystals larger than that of the starting material is produced. Attractive forces between solid particles. So electrostatic forces may be important in the powder mixing or powder cohesion and initial formation of agglomerates during mixing. But van der Waals forces are greater than the electrostatic forces and they contribute significantly to the strength of the granules produced by dry granulation. The magnitude of these forces will increase as the distance between adjacent surfaces decreases, and in dry granulation it is achieved by using pressure to force the particles together. Mechanical interlocking. So feature and deformation due to pressure that produces shape related bonding or intertwining of long fibrous particles. The mechanical interlocking theory of adhesion states that good adhesion occurs. Mechanism of granule formation. So in the dry granulation method, particle adhesion occurs caused by compaction pressure or applied pressure. A compact or sheet is produced which is larger than the granule size required, and therefore the required size can be attained by milling and sieving. Whereas in wet granulation, liquid added to dry powders has to be distributed throughout the powder by the mechanical adsorption created in the granulator. The particles adhere to each other because of liquid films, and further adsorption or liquid addition causes more particles to adhere. The precise mechanism by which dry powder is transformed into a bed of granules varies for each type of granulation equipment. So the granulation mechanism can be divided into three stages. So when the granulation is done manually, that is blending and then forming the damp mass, which is then passed through the screen and then drying. So all these stages involve, and these convert the dry powder into the granule form by involving these mechanisms, that is nucleation, transition and wall growth. So same mechanisms can be there when the granulation is done with the high shear granulator or other granulation in the other such type of granulators. So nucleation, so granulation starts with adhesion among particles due to liquid bridges and the formation of agglomerates at capillary state. So just what we discussed, capillary state, pendular state, funicular state and capillary state. So granulation starts with adhesion among particles due to liquid bridges and the formation of agglomerates at capillary state. A number of particles will join to form the pendular state, and further adsorption densities then pendular bodies to form the capillary state, and these bodies act nuclei for further granule growth. So nuclei can grow in two possible ways. The first way is single particles added to the nuclei by pendular bridges, that is liquid bridges formation, or by combining two or more nuclei. So what the pendular state is there, to that another nuclei will add. So the combined nuclei will be reshaped by the agitation of the bead. So this stage is characterized by the presence of large number of small granules with a fairly wide size distribution, providing that this distribution is not excessively large. This is a suitable endpoint for granules used in capsule and tablet manufacture, as relatively small granules will produce a uniform tablet dye or capsule. Next stage is transition. So nuclei can grow in two possible ways, that is either single particles added and combined nuclei will be reshaped. So this is the transition stage of the granule formation. Then ball growth. So first is the nucleation, second is the transition, and the third one is ball growth. So further granule growth produces large spherical granules, and the mean particle size of the granulating system will increase with time. So coalescence takes place between two nuclei. So there may be the breakage of the nuclei, and then again abrasion transfer, and then layering may be there. So these are the different mechanisms of wall growth during granulation. So the first mechanism is coalescence, second is breakage, third is abrasion transfer, and the fourth is layering. So if agitation is continued, granule coalescence will continue and produce an unstable overmass system. This, although this is dependent upon the amount liquid added and the properties of the material being granulated, but this system is unstable and overmass, this may be again break and converted. So although ball growth produces granules that may too large for pharmaceutical purposes, some degree of ball growth will occur in planetary mixers, and it is an essential feature for some spheronizing equipments. So the first mechanism, that is coalescence, so two or more granules join to form a larger granule. Breaking of granules, so break into fragments which adhere to other granules, forming the layer of material over the surviving granule. In abrasion transfer, agitation of the granule bed leads to the attrition of material from granules. So this abraded material adheres to the granules, increasing their size. Then the last step is in ball growth, that is layering. So when a second batch of powder mix is added to a bed of granules, second batch of powder mix will adhere to the granule. So this is the granule, and forming a layer over the surface, and thus increases the granule size. So the transition from a non-granulated to an overmass system is very rapid, and monitoring equipment is necessary to stop the granulation at predetermined point. So this process should be controlled one. These are some of the recent advances in wet granulation technology. So in an urge to improve commercial output of pharmaceutical formulations, wet granulation process has witnessed various technical and technological innovations, such as steam granulation, moisture activated dry granulation or moist granulation, freeze granulation, thermal adhesion granulation, melt granulation or thermoplastic granulation, foam granulation, and reverse wet granulation or reverse phase wet granulation. Now the next step in tablet formulation. The first step in tablet formulation was particle size reduction. Second was mixing or blending. Third is the granulation. And now the fourth is drying. So the once the granules get formed, so these screen moist granules are dried in an oven at a controlled temperature not exceeding 55 degrees Celsius, to a consistent weight or constant moisture content. The drying temperature and the duration of drying process depend on the nature of the active ingredient and the level of the moisture required for the successful production of satisfactory tablets. So tray dryer and fluidized bed dryer can be used for this purpose. Sizing the granulation by dry screening. The next step is, after drying, the granules are screened through the dry screens. So the dried granules are passed through a screen of smaller size than that used to prepare the moist granules. So here vibroshifter is one of the equipment which can help to screen the granules of different size. The size of the final granules is dependent on the size of the punches, that is the final tablet size. So screens of 14 to 20 mesh size are generally used for the sizing of granulation after dry screening. Lubrication of granules. After dry screening, the dried and screened granules are separated into coarse and fine granules by shaking them on a 250 mesh sieve. Appropriate quantity of lubricant is passed through the 200 mesh sieve and this is mixed with the fine granules before the coarse granules are incorporated. The quantity of lubricant used varies from one formulation scientist to another, but usually ranges from about 0.1% to 5% of the weight of the granulation. So examples of the lubricants which are used commonly in wet granulation are magnesium stearate, calcium stearate, stearic acid, hydrogenated vegetable oil, talc and starch. But the magnesium stearate is most preferred lubricant, except in some of the drugs with which this is incompatible. Then compaction by direct compression. So up to this stage, we discuss the different steps involving formulation of tablets. So compaction is done by direct compression. So here the powder material is directly compressed with the directly compressible vehicles, means other tablet ingredients. These are blended along with the lubricant and the tablet is compressed. Means here no granulation step, as some of the powder materials, they have a property, ideal property of compaction. They are compressible. So these are the directly compressible vehicles are added along with the active ingredient which is having compaction, good compaction properties. Compression of granules. So the powders which are not to be compressed directly by direct compression, so there is need to prepare the granules. So mixed granules are compressed in a single punch or multi-station tablet press fitted with appropriate punches and dies. Compressed tablets may be coated if there is need to mask the taste of unpleasant drugs, increase the aesthetic appeal of the uncoated tablet, and modify or control the release of the therapeutic agents from the tablet. So this is achieved by enclosing or covering the core tablet or granules with coating solutions. So this is the different stages involved in the formulation of tablets. Thank you.